Hi everyone, I'm Claudia, I'm 26 and I'm from Italy, and I'm here for the next video of the HDYO Community Stories. These are video recorded for the community, to the community, where we share experiences and advices. And HDYO is always here to support you, and if you want, you can find more resources at hdyo.org. And we are here today with Sarina. So, hi Sarina, and I don't know, can you maybe start by telling us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, thank you, Claudia. Hi, my name is Sarina. I'm 23 years old. I'm from the United States, from Pennsylvania. And I currently just started grad school in cellular and molecular biology. And yeah, my mom has HD in my family. And today I'll be talking a little bit about caregiving and how that's changed over the years. And yeah, that's a little bit about me.
Yeah, that's great. And I don't know, can you maybe, I don't know, share a little bit about your family history and when did you start actually taking the role of a caregiver?
Yeah, so my mom, she's in the advanced stages of Huntington's right now. And my aunt, my mom's sister also had HD. And she passed away in 2018. And then they inherited the gene from my grandmother. So she passed away like right around when I was a baby. So like I never really knew anyone in my family who had HD, because by the time I was old enough to be aware of what it was, my grandmother had already passed away. And I'm at risk for HD, so I haven't been tested. And then my sister tested positive. And so we're the only two really in our family who are impacted since our cousins were adopted. So it's been a little bit of a interesting position for the two of us. And I'm really grateful to have her support too and be by my side.
That's great. I have a sister too, and we are kind of like the only ones in our family to relate it to HD, and it's, I can totally relate. And talking about caregiving, and I know how hard that can be. So what were, I don't know, some of the initial challenges that you faced when first starting actually caregiving?
Yeah, so I'd say I would consider myself a caregiver more actually when my mom started going into the nursing home, even though then again, a lot of the nurses were taking care of her and a lot of her care was on the nurses. Before that, I was living at home with my mom and dad. And so my dad took on a lot of the caregiving. At the time, I was around like 13, 14. And so they really wanted me to focus on school and try to have as normal of a childhood as I could. So I'm really grateful for all my dad did to help my mom. It was getting to a point where it was really challenging and her cognitive abilities were getting a lot worse. And so it was time for her to move into nursing care. And she also had a rough, even though my father did a lot to care for her, I know as like met as many of his experience with HD, there's like agitation and some of it is like unawareness. So she wasn't really aware of her symptoms and how she was progressing, and she would get angry at my dad when he was just trying to help her. So it was really tough for him to be caring for her, but also her getting a little agitated sometimes and not really understanding why she needs like more care and things like that. So their relationship was really difficult, and I think going into nursing care, some of that was challenging. So it mostly fell on me to go visit her and make sure she was getting the care she needed from the nursing home. And so it was really challenging at first going, because emotionally to see like my mom progressing to that state, because neither of us had ever wanted her to go into a nursing home. So I remember for a really long time, it just felt very lonely and isolating. Until like I found HDYO and more resources, because before that I wasn't really involved in anything. So it kind of feels like you're on your own little island, and I didn't really talk about this to anyone. So it was really a difficult time initially adjusting to that transition period and having more of the caregiving fall on me.
And thank you for sharing. And I just wanted to remember to to remember something to anyone. That's every situation, it's its own. Even though like our situation, I haven't had the chance to meet you, and our situation it's really similar. And it's weird because every time you get a new situation, because there are a lot of different types of caregiving and needing in families, and each situation it's its own. You can have a single caregiver, a primary, a secondary, many caregivers who coordinate, and that's really the unique thing about HD, that every family handle its, I don't know, on its own. And so about you, I just want to ask about your daily routine. I don't know, when you actually became a caregiver, how did that with studies that you told me you study a lot of biology, and that's great, how did it actually change? I don't know, maybe a typical day that you go through during caregiving.
So I think around the time, it's been a while now that she's been in a nursing home. So initially I was around like 15 years old. And by that point I was just starting high school. And so I think it was very more challenging for me emotionally because the nurses were taking care of a lot of her physical needs. I think going to see her each week or sometimes multiple times a week was really like emotionally draining on me. And I know I felt guilty for that too, because like you want to see your mom and you want to visit her and things like that. But with going to school and like I didn't tell anyone about this, so it's sort of like my other secret life beyond outside of school. It was really tough to deal with. And then going to college, I chose to go to a college closer to home. So I was still able to see her on like the weekends and stuff too. That was a little weird sometimes too, because it'd be like people would ask me to like go out and do things, or like you want to hang out with friends, maybe like I'm gonna go see my mom this day, like, and try to like prioritize seeing her, but also like making time for my studies was really challenging. So I think that's more of it. I think on a day-to-day basis, I think it was more emotionally challenging than physically challenging, because at that point, yeah, like I said, the nurses took on a lot of that role, which I was really grateful for.
Yeah, and thank you for sharing. I can imagine the difficulty of actually opening up to people and explaining what this situation is. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, have some of your friends and family support you through this journey?
Yeah, I think definitely it was around 2017 when I found HDYO. And so I went to the youth camp. That was like my first time meeting other like teenagers affected by the disease, because before that I wouldn't really tell any of my friends at home about what I was going through. So it felt very freeing to make friends there and talk about these things with others who could relate on a deeper level. And so I maintained some of those friendships until now, which has been really, I'm really grateful for. And then I've also had a lot of great support from my aunt and uncle too, and they go to see her a lot. So it's been really nice to know that they're there to support her too. If I'm like having a bad week and I'm like, I really can't like go to see her, that this time that like they're still there and they're still like checking up on her and looking out for me too. So I'm really grateful for all my family has done for me as well.
Yeah, that's great. The support of people that are in your situation, that's really something that you can't explain. The first time I met actually someone from an HD family who was my age, I was like, wow, this is incredible. So I can totally relate to that. But on the other hand, because I personally know that there are a lot of them, did you face any, I don't know, misunderstanding or lack of support, voluntary or involuntary, from those around you?
I think it was a little challenging, more like when I got to college and things start progressing to a certain point, I started like telling people a little bit more about my mom, then like also keeping some things more to myself. And I think it was hard for some people to like sometimes understand like what I was going through, or like if you tell somebody about Huntington's, like, oh, my mom is like in this situation. Sometimes people don't really know how to react, because it can be a lot to kind of just like put on someone at once. So I was trying to learn like what to share with people to not overwhelm them, but also like educate people about Huntington's and like not keep it like a secret from people. But there's always gonna be like reactions you don't expect from people, and I think it's important to keep in mind too that like it doesn't necessarily mean they don't care about you or anything like that. Sometimes there are just like bad people, but a lot of the times it's just people don't really know how to react in those situations. So like what's important is that they're willing to understand and learn. So like to not be totally freaked out if somebody kind of just goes silent or like doesn't know how to help you. I think it's like it's a back and forth, and I think learning how to better communicate about HD has also helped me tell others like the support that I need and what I need from them. So I think, yeah. But I would say that overwhelmingly amount of times that I've told people, it's been positive, and they're like, yeah, I'm here to support you. Like, tell me what you need. Yeah.
Yeah, I can relate. Like, weird things have happened to me too, but I think that's just a way of people not understanding and knowing actually what, I don't know, what to say or how to react. So that's life. People are like that sometimes, but that's okay. And for me, I always try to educate them and like to give them, I don't know, maybe if you want to read more about them, I don't know, you can check this. Or you can ask me whatever you want, and that's great because I think that the support and the information are what actually help people understand. And speaking of support and information, I wanted to ask you what kind of help, professional help or medical support have you and your mom, of course, received?
Yeah, so for me personally, I wish I got therapy sooner. Probably in high school it would have been really helpful for me, but throughout college too, especially when I could get it through free through my college, I was able to find a therapist who was really helpful through talking through all these things, and she sort of like understood intuitively some things that like I wouldn't expect a therapist to ne necessarily like put together. So it felt really nice to have someone. Because she seemed very willing to like learn about Huntington's and help me through things. So I think finding a therapist that works with you is really important, and sometimes it takes like more than one person to find one that fits well. And yeah, and now my mom too, when she was at home for a bit, she received like home nursing care too. She got a little frustrated with some of like the aides and stuff caring for her too, because that's just she kind of wanted to do things on her own and like have her own space. But they were pretty helpful if like people need extra care at home. There's organizations that you can have aides or nurses come to your house. So I think that was helpful. And yeah, and then all of just like the support from HDYO, and then the in the US, we have the National Youth Alliance. And so they have a lot of social workers and support through these organizations too. And I think it's been super helpful for me to be able to connect with others. I'm gonna attend these events and hear from others.
Yeah, that's great. I know something about someone don't want not wanting the help of others because they think they can do it on their own. But yeah, I can relate, but that's okay. But you told me about when your mom was at home, so I just wanted to ask you if there are some things that you miss of actually having her at home, or I don't know if you want to share something about that.
Yeah, I really wish. Yeah, I think at that time she started showing symptoms when I was very young, so it was harder for us to have like that closer relationship. But I really miss at home. She would always like take our dog for walks, or have her like silly jokes and antics, and things like that. So I know it would have been very nice to keep her at home for as long as, possible. But she needed like the extra care. Yeah, I think just having like that mother-daughter relationship is something I really miss too.
Yeah, and thank you for sharing that. And if you had to give some advice to someone that has just started caregiving, I don't know, what would you want to say?
Yeah, I think definitely take time for yourself too. I know it can feel like a lot of pressure, a lot of responsibilities. And I think sometimes when you're caregiving, you learn to put like a lot of attention on others, and then you kind of ignore yourself sometimes and what you need. And your loved one wants what's best for you too. So they don't want you to be suffering. So you got to keep that in mind too, and like take care of your mental health, do things that make you happy. Take a break and reach out for help too. Like, understand you're not alone. Like, you don't have to do these things alone. I think that understanding was probably the most powerful for me. Because before that, it's like no one, you kind of feel like no one else can relate to this, like going to see your mom in like a care home. But then you learn there's lots of people in the HD community that have similar experiences, and that can offer support and advice. So I think don't be afraid to reach out.
Yeah, thank you. And if I have to add something, it's don't feel guilty to just take your time because that's what you need to better caring for the person that you have to care. Because if you're stressed out, you can't do it right. It's just not possible. So that's really a great advice. And I don't know, I just want to ask about your future. You told me that you just started studying biology. So what goals do you have for your future, both for you and also for your mom?
Yeah, I think what I'm really hoping is to at least make like a positive impact on the world in whatever way I can. And yeah, I've tried to, despite all the challenges HD has brought to like me and my family, I try to like find the positives. So that's kind of how I led towards studying biology, is hoping I can get better treatments, better therapies, and pushing for these cures. Yeah, and I think for my mom too, I just want her to be remembered for more than HD, because I feel like a lot of the times HD kind of consumes like your whole world, but I always find it really nice when I hear her friends like talk about stories from when they were growing up, and I see pictures of her and our dog, and seeing her smile, and like those small moments where you feel like you can really connect again. I think I really want to cherish those. And make sure people remember that, and remind them to like to think of my mom as beyond like just this disease.
Yeah, thank you. Because what you said, it's just so far powerful to be remembered, not for the disease, but also for the person that's behind it and for our character and our personality and our hobbies and everything like that. And that's really important. So thank you. Thank you for sharing it. And I don't know, is there anything else that you would like to share, to add, to say?
I think to just emphasize your point too of like not feeling guilty for taking time for yourself, because that's like the way you're going to be the best caregiver, is when you're feeling good and cared for. So in finding those resources that you can go to in times of need.
So, Sarina, really, thank you so much. And I just want to remember to all of you guys that you are not alone. You're not supposed to do this by yourself. We are here to support you and to do whatever we can. And Sarina, again, thank you for sharing us your story and your experience. That was really powerful. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.